Praise the Lord. Let's pray.
Hallelujah.
All right. Praise the Hallelujah. Happy, happy, happy.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. All right. Well, you supposed to call me tonight?
What up?
That's a bad sign.
I hear your question.
So he's supposed to be calling you tonight, right?
Yes.
Oh, okay, we'll have to do about 5 or 10 minutes to get people warmed up and get more people a chance to come. On page 24, we just want to just do these three, and we'll do the other ones after. Questions for thought. We just want to discuss that so everybody can. Page 24. Questions for thought. These questions are based on information that we shared last week. And we just want to do three, and we'll let Brother Wayne share with us, and then we'll come back and do the exercises 1 through 5. Give 25 minutes, and you can get a lot in. Brother Travis got a whole lot in, say 3 minutes. Brother Travis getting professional, man. Tying all that together. I said, I hope 3 minutes won't catch up in the middle of something you're trying to get over. All right. But we just thank God for all of you. Thank God for you that's committed to the Bible studies. I know that sometimes it's difficult to make it to every session. We're going to hold you accountable. This Wednesday, we're going to hold you accountable for Saturday evening. So I got a whole lot of people to deal with so far that didn't show up Wednesday, didn't show up Saturday evening. Of course, this past Sunday evening was Easter. So I guess they had an excuse, right? Easter. All right. So I had to come Brother Butler's wife. She attended Sunday evening. That was a real blessing. She talks. I mean, she knows the word. All right. So I just want to kind of break the ice here, and we just want some responses to these three questions for thought. Number one, Sister Hill, you want to do this? You want to take these three? She said, in what ways are believers like Moses was when he was first called to be Israel's deliverer? In what ways are believers like Moses was when he was first called to be Israel's deliverer? All right.
One way we're like Moses is often we're reluctant to accept the charge that's given us, feeling like we're incapable, or thinking that the task is insurmountable for us, mm-hmm. that we don't have the ability to meet the challenge.
Mm-hmm.
And Moses was like that, and we too were. Because Moses, I mean, the undertaking that God was asking him to do was massive, to deal with all these people. I'm not sure Moses at the time knew they were going to be rebellious, but anytime you get a group of people, that large a group, you know you're going to have some cantankerous people in the midst. So most people you don't want to deal with that, so there's a reluctance there. And then the other thing, you know, I didn't think that he could articulate well.
Mm-hmm.
He wouldn't be able to get the message across. So it was so many ways like, no, Lord, someone else. And we're similar to that way, you know, to let somebody else do it.
Mm-hmm. Okay, anybody else? Okay, now what do you think, what is it that causes people to feel inferior when they are called upon to carry out a specific task or mission for the Lord? What is it that causes people to feel inferior or incapable, or feel like they are not up to the responsibility or the task or the assignment? What is it that causes people to feel inferior?
Maybe fear. Fear.
All right, well,
it's the same thing as like you asking a question. Mm-hmm. I don't know how many of us here tonight, but how many people respond? And I, you know, you don't know, and other various, we don't know why people, you know, sometimes people think, well, if I say something, it may be the wrong thing, or I just don't feel like talking, or, you know, just maybe, you know, I think as others have said, it's fear. And fear takes many different forms.
Yeah, sometimes we take fear of failure.
Right.
When my first thought, fear that I wouldn't be able to live up.
Could be.
And fear that you would be leading them in the wrong way.
Are you going to go on the strength?
Fear you would be leading them in the wrong way, telling them something. Something different than what God wants you to tell me.
Okay, who's the author of fear?
Satan.
God is not the author of what? Okay, fear comes from... Okay, so Satan has established a very close relationship with our minds because all of the enticements and temptations that he uses in order to restrain us from carrying out God's will or for even getting involved in doing evil is presented to the mind first. That's the battleground. Everybody agree? And all of the enticements, temptations, and whatever Satan succeeds in doing, he first has to get the consent through your he has to present it to the mind, the screen of imagination, the mind. He introduce whatever he wants you to tap in on. He introduces it to your mind, like a screen that have all types of, starting with this. You say, no, not. So y'all heard me tell the story about the man that went to this big sale, and they had all of these instruments that he uses to defeat Christians. He had all of these different instruments. He had lion. The devil has a whole lot of different devices to distract, to disturb, to ensnare us. So he had all of these enticements that he uses to ensnare me in, up on for sale. And he had different prices attached to various ones because some were a lot more, expensive than the others because they were a lot more effective. Now, what are some of the instruments, you think, devices that Satan probably uses more than others to lure people into darkness or to get them distracted from a straight and narrow way? You might think of some. What do y'all think are some of the main strategies and tactics that the devil launches that usually cause people to fall or to give in or to be seduced very easily? Well, just take a stab at it. What would you think some of them?
Thoughts of my past failures.
So what?
Thoughts of my past failures.
Okay, just
thoughts of past failures.
Thoughts of past failures, okay. All right, let's name some more.
Discouragement.
All right, name some more.
Creating doubt.
Beg your pardon?
Creating doubt.
All right, creating doubt. All right. So he doesn't get anybody here to smoke or smoke weed or anything like that. Go to the club or to the disco or to the casino, nobody here. He entices that because most of the time people say, no, I can't be seen at the casino. If I'm going to sin, I want to do it on the cup. I don't want nobody to know it. But there are, the Bible calls the pride of pride of life, the, let me see, the lust of the flesh, the love of the, see, those three things are those. Okay, love not the world, neither the things that are of the world. Okay, these three things are not of God, but of the world. They are the love of the world. What is the lust of the eyes, the pride of life. That's not in 1 John 2:14. The three things, I want 1 John 2:14 or 15. But those are the things that usually, I would say most people are going to be ensnared by the lust of the eyes. Love of the world. Lust of the flesh.
Lust of the eyes.
Mm-hmm.
And the pride of life.
Okay, pride of life. Okay, those are some of the main devices that the enemy will use to get, because most of those would be very subtle. Nobody sees anything wrong with the lust of the eyes. The Bible said the eyes are ever seeing, and but they don't ever get enough. They always want to what? Gaze at things. And that's how many times we are enticed. And we, the Bible says man is tempted when he's drawn away of his own lust and enticed. Most enticements will come those ways. Lust of the flesh, what is lust of the eyes, and the what? Pride of life. Pride of life is a real huge one, but it's very subtle. And most people will never know pride, even if you try to bring it to their attention. They wouldn't think that they would be in pride. But these are some of the subtle strategies and tactics of the enemy to ensnare people. And he always uses the instruments of our bodies. In other words, our members. He uses the members of our bodies to carry out. Because, see, as long as that temptation is in the mind realm, he's waiting for somebody to what? Just like he's waiting for somebody to what? To bite the bait. Right? That's what the enemy, but you bring all of these things through your mind. How many thoughts do you have during the day? All kind of stuff come by your mind, right? How many know that during a period of a day, a whole lot of ungodly things come by your mind? Right? All right, so he'll say, if you guard your mind, you won't have nothing. Because he'll say, you won't have that many. The Bible says he'll keep your mind in perfect peace when your minds are watched. But the average person will be bombarded by what? A whole lot. If they don't have their minds tightly girded, it is got to be good, girded, guarded. So that means that you have to consistently be engaged in doing things that are what? Good, pure, wholesome, honest, things of a good report, right? These are the things that we are to what consistently think of, because if we lose control of our thought life, then it's going to be easy for the enemy to land that fatal what? Blow. He's going to get you to do something using your members. He's going to work through your eyes. And you'll work on that, that thing's going to become more and more and more and more enticing until at some point, as your flesh will begin to respond to that what enticement, as you begin to use your eyes, then more than likely, if a person is not strong in the Lord, they're going to what? Submit. So the devil uses your eyes, your hands, the members of your body, right? Your feet, right? The members of your body. And the big thing that he uses a lot is your tongue. That's the worst one. Uncontrolled, out of control of your what? Tongue. So these are some of the things the enemy uses to get us in sin and to draw us back into darkness and to defeat us and help us to break fellowship with the Lord. Okay, but the enemy had all of these devices up for sale, and the implement or the instrument or the device that outcost all of the others that he had was the instrument of what?
Discouragement.
And somebody asked the devil, why is, you know, the lying and fornication and all of the others, all of those bad ones, the price was pretty modest. But when it came to discouragement, he had a real high price tag on discouragement. And they asked him why was the price of discouragement was so high. And he said that this is a device that I can use to get even believers to submit to. Because most believers are not going to just lie deliberately. They're not going to go to the disco. They're not going to commit certain things. They're not going to do the blatant sins. But if I can get them discouraged, then I can what? Open the door for them to be enticed to do things that they never dreamed that they would do. When a person is down in the dumps, they're right, discouraged, upset, disturbed. We say all kind of things. I ain't gonna go back to Northside no more. I mean, we say all kind of stuff. And we say, I don't feel like reading my Bible. You know, all types of things will come into play when you're discouraged. So that's the instrument or the implement that the devil uses more than any other believers. How many believe that? How many have been discouraged? All right. When I feel discouraged, I say, oh man, I'm just, first thing come to your mind, why don't you just give somebody a piece of your mind? And I say, well, then I think so, deal, so you don't have enough. The little bit you got, you need, so you better hold on to it.
Pastor, can I give another analogy related to this question?
Okay.
It's a lot like applying for a job.
Yeah.
We apply for a job because we feel like we're qualified for it. But in this case with Moses and a lot of times with us, this job is not something that we apply for per se, but we don't feel like we're qualified for it in the beginning.
Mm-hmm.
And it takes time to grow into that job.
Right. That's good. So it's the same thing about Moses. It took him time to what? Grow into that state of what having what? Trust and confidence in God. As he talked with the Lord, right, as he prayed, as the Bible says he talked to God face to face, just like a friend. And as he carried out God's will, and as he saw God come through time and time and time again, then that began to build his what? Confidence and his trust in the Lord, and he began to get more comfortable in his role. So obeying God is a way that you get settled in your faith. Obeying God, carrying out his will, also we call it close communion. Everybody touch somebody and say close communion. All right, close communion is the thing that enables you to feel a lot closer to God and feel the strength of God. And it's not good to feel like you are all alone. But prayer and God, hearing God's voice and seeing God work for you, open doors, make ways, answer your prayers, lead and guide you by pillar of cloud by what? Day, and a pillar of fire by night. Supplying food in the wilderness when there was no food. These are the things that gives you confidence and trust, and you'll begin to grow in that awareness that you're not alone. God is with me, he's in me, he's for me, with God before me. It doesn't matter who comes against me. So that's good, brother. Rod, we give you an A+ on that. That's pretty good.
I'll take it.
Whatever I need, for somebody to come through, Rod's always a man. Give him a good God bless you. All right, we're going to do one more question and then we'll go on. To what can you attribute Moses' ability to do all the mighty works he did? To what can you attribute Moses' ability to do all of the mighty works that he did?
Obedience and faith.
All right. Anybody else? Anything different? to what did you contribute Moses' ability to do all that he did? Okay.
Trusting in the Lord. All right, that's what he did.
All right, so you can always tell whether you're on the right track when you look at the answers on the back, okay? It says, by being obedient to his voice, by being led by the Holy Spirit, and by praying numerous times for help. There were many times Moses fell down before the Lord, and he what? Prayed, prostrate. He was flat on his face. So, all right, let's do the last one, then we'll be able to go forward, okay? The last question is what now? Y'all read it for me.
In order to stand, you want to read together?
Yes, everybody read together.
In order to stand up under all that Moses had to contend with, what would the land appear to be?
All right. In order to stand up under all that Moses had to contend with, this is throughout his ministry, what will one have to do? All right, Brother Travis, Brother Sonny said, trust God for sure. All right.
Seek the Lord.
Have to what?
Seek the Lord's wisdom. Yeah.
All right. Seek the Lord's wisdom.
Move away from God.
What else?
Moses knew the ways of God because he stayed in the Lord's presence.
Right.
Talked to God face to face.
Right. You have to know the ways of God. Anything else? Good. To be called what? Chosen and appointed. All right. So if you're in the wrong position and you're trying to carry out God's will, it's going to be very difficult. You're going to have to be what? Called, anointed, appointed. And that's a main criteria. That's one of the main points that we need to always consider. Okay, let me see, is there anything else? Anybody else got anything to say about that? Yes.
How many leaders do you think, percentage-wise, today, life would be to emulate Moses?
All right, that's a question. Can everybody hear her? Scale from 1 to 8? 1 to 10?
Spiritual leaders.
Spiritual leaders. Spiritual leaders, I should say.
Spiritual leaders.
Yes.
I don't know, but I think it's a really low percentage. And I say that because when we listen to a lot of spiritual leaders, we hear a lot of ungodly facts coming even from them, or ungodly thoughts even coming from them, or ungodly actions coming from them as well. And I know that those spiritual leaders are just a representation of the general public, but I'm just going to say a very, very small percentage for me.
Yeah, I agree.
Right.
I agree. I think it's a small percentage.
Very seldom you will find a person that's willing to make the sacrifice that Moses made. He was willing to what? To give up.
Almost laid out his
lay down his life. Well, that's what every great hero, man of faith that we read about in the Bible, they all follow the same. Jesus had to lay down his life. He had to give up everything that he was about in terms of emptying himself, of his mighty power and glory. Paul said, I count all things but what? Loss. Moses chose to suffer affliction with the people of God than to enjoy the pledges of sin for a season. And he renounced all of his entitlements, honors and positions and all of those that were due him as a king's son in order to carry out the God's will and to be in a position where he could answer the call of God and actually fulfill that call. I want you to just turn to one scripture here in Psalms 18. Someone used to say there's power in a holy life. There's power in a holy life. And of course we know the scripture in James and the wisdom of God, the wisdom from heaven is first pure. Amen. So God can't use people that are not straight, that's not right, that's not pure, that's not clean. That's probably the most important prerequisite for being a channel for God to work through. You got to be what? Clean, because God does not dwell in a what? Unclean temple. And your body is the temple where God has to what? Carry out his will. Whatever God is going to do, he's going to do it through your what? Your temple, your spirit. And our bodies are members of Christ. We are the temple that God resides in. And God demands that that temple be what? Holy. If he's going to what? Lead and control and dominate your life. You just can't drag God in the presence of a whole lot of unclean things. I mean, your spirit will always be what? Will be impacted. I mean, fellowship will be broken every time when you drag your spirit in the presence of things that's unholy, ungodly. God will always what? Break fellowship. The Holy Spirit will always what? Disconnect you. All right, so that's very pure, and I remember years ago they said there's power in a holy life. Scripture says that God, if your heart doesn't condemn you, God is greater than your heart and knows all things. So that's the prerequisite for what? Answered prayer. He says that if your heart does not condemn you, in other words, if there is a heart void of all offense, everybody just say offense. Amen. You can't look back over your life and have unfinished business and this going and that going and things that you haven't repented of and really have a clear conscience before God. So if any scripture says that if your heart doesn't condemn you, then what? You will have what? Confidence before God. And whatever you ask. Now, y'all think I'm making that up, but I want you to turn right there, 1 John, whatever you ask, see, it's boldness and confidence, and that's your ability to walk in righteousness, is that boldness and confidence and that sense of a voidness of offense toward God and toward man. So it says that, beloved, 1 John 3:21, beloved, if our heart condemn us not, then have we confidence toward God. And whatsoever we ask, we receive of him, because we keep his commandments and do those things that are what? Pleasing in his sight. So that's the thing that causes your faith to what? Emerge. If a person has strong faith in God, it's because he's living a godly life. Amen. He's in close fellowship with the Lord. And in order to be in close fellowship with the Lord, you got to be what? Pure and holy. Now, that scripture, I never got to Psalms 18. And that's the reason why we are teaching on holiness. There's a whole lot needs to be shared in that particular area of holiness. I mean, restraining your members and controlling your members, your body. Sanctification is all about what? Controlling your body, controlling your tongue, controlling your mind, controlling your flesh, controlling your desires. That's what holiness is strictly about. It's about your control over your physical body. Okay, Psalms 18, it says this, 21, for I have kept the ways of the Lord and have not wickedly departed from my God. For all his judgments were before me, and I did not put away his statutes from me. I was also upright before him, and I kept myself from mine iniquity. I kept myself. So we see that God gives us the ability to keep ourselves. Therefore hath the Lord recompensed me according to my righteousness, according to the cleanness of my hands and his eyesight. With the merciful thou wilt show thyself merciful, with an upright man thou wilt show thyself upright, with the pure thou wilt show thyself pure, and with the forward thou wilt show thyself forward. But that really stuck with me, verse 24. Therefore hath the Lord recompensed me according to my righteousness, according to the cleanness of my hands in his eyesight. So God rewards us according to the cleanness of our hands, because our faith will be no greater than the cleanness of our hands or the life that we live, our holiness that we walk in. How many can say amen to that? That's the reason why Moses, 18:10, Moses did everything that the Lord would command him to do. He did it exactly. If you look through Moses' life, there was only one time, I believe, that Moses actually disobeyed God. Was it one time or two times? Amen. When he disrespected the people of God, right? Called them rebels. And he smote the rock instead of speaking to the rock, okay? That was pretty good, dealing with about 3 million rebellious people for 40 years. That's a pretty good record, right? All right, we got Brother Wayne to come and just share what he has gleaned from Moses. I mean, I know he got some deep stuff, so we're gonna just give him time to just share his thoughts. All of this will be flowing together as he comes. Let's say praise the Lord. Amen.
Lean on him and not into my own understanding. that in all of my ways acknowledge him, he shall direct our path. And I thank him for, you know, putting within our hearts and our minds to serve and have a desire to seek after him.
Yes.
And as Moses, you know, as he followed after God and sought after him, God had instructed him. It was just some of the things that he had mentioned that I saw in there were, you know, it seemed simple when he was faced to the task. He just got before God and asked him simple questions. When a whole lot of deep stuff was involved, not a whole lot of scripture. God, how did I deal with this matter? Lead me. If you don't lead and direct me, I won't go. But if you lead me and guide me, I'll go.
Yes.
Ain't nothing complicated about that. But when it comes down to today's term in our lives, seeing something lost, something missing, and you know, we have the Holy Spirit. That's what he said, God will give you a comforter to lead and guide you, direct you. And we say we have that in our lives, but sometimes we still seem like we miss God speaking to us and hearing his voice. Maybe we busy with our schedule or what have you. Because one thing you can be sure of, when you fellowship enough with someone, you recognize their voice. No matter, you know, where I'm at, am in the house or what, in another a group of people, and I consider myself, for the most part, very soft-spoken, I'm pretty sure my wife recognized my voice. Other folks might be a little loud and over my speech, but she heard me. I mean, she called me honey and baby, a few other good stuff. You know, but she recognized our voice, and that's through fellowship. And I think somehow or another, through our fellowship and our consistent fellowship with God, that we don't hear him when he speaks to us. Because I believe he speaks to us all the time. Because we understand his words or his promises based on better promises than the New Testament. It's better. So I mean, to me, if it's something better, it ought to be a little bit easier, you think? So somehow or other, either we made it somewhat kind of complicated with our own life, or not either, just not spending time with him and allowing him to actually lead us. Because I know just on this week something he spoke to me, and I know I heard it. I mean, he's not a complicated God. And he's not a very mystical, he's not very far. The Bible says he's nigh unto us. Closer to the words of our mouth. He's there. Long you speak in his word as God. And he will speak to you in a given situation that you want direction from. Sometimes you have to recognize when he comes to us. A lot of time when he comes to us, a lot of time we might not recognize. Because we already got a conceived idea of how things should go. But then he wants to take you a different way, and you don't, and it costs your mind, you know, already made up this way that you want to go, then you don't recognize him. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Well, praise the Lord. I probably answered the questions. And I'm going to say this a little bit. I know we know what's going on in the world. I'm going to go to what I'm supposed to do, but I'm not going to be here very long. I just want to, it seemed like this in my heart to say this, and I didn't want sure if I was going to call up today or not. I went over the lesson, sure enough. But it just did just something to me in my heart to say about, you know, this stuff that's going on. And we really, thanks to God and all of our family members and friends that we know, we need to take things serious when it comes down to voting.
Amen.
Very serious.
Amen.
I mean, because we don't understand what the plot is and whatever's going on. I'm not, you know, trying to, you know, I'm going to say a little bit and just move on. And, you know, really motivate your family members to get involved with voting. Because all along, the reason why we're losing a lot of what we have, because we don't get into the process. And when we do vote, we vote because this person, maybe we don't even know nothing about them. Their name is Alan, but my name is Alan. Check him off. You know? But we need to get involved and know so much about these people that we'll put in place to get these things to change. But otherwise, we're going to see a lot of things erased very quickly with the wrong people getting in office. So I move on to what I'm supposed to do. Hallelujah. Glory to God. The first question that it has is, number one, so what do you consider the greatest indications of Moses' complete surrender to the will of God? Like I said, Pastor did a good job with the book. That you don't know the answer. You don't have time to look up the answer. You can just scan it, copy and paste it in there on your computer. From the answer in the back of the book. I don't think it's no easier than that. So I assume that everybody has some kind of answers in their spaces.
Let's go around and check.
And page 19, I have saw some answers in that from that perspective. Right there where it says, where it talks about Hebrews 11:25. I was choosing rather to suffer affliction with the people of God than enjoy the pleasures of sin for a season. So that tells me one thing, he had a choice. I mean, this is just simply put, he was facing a choice. He said, man, I can go back to Egypt where I had it good. Things already laid out for me. I can go, you know, suffer the affliction and hardship. Now, truth now, how many else would have chose to go back to Egypt? I mean, I want to see the hand. This is not a rhetorical question. Which direction you think you would have chose? Which, I mean, most likely you faced in a situation, a hard-pressed situation, because most time we like to choose the most easy way out. You know, the old saying, work smarter, not harder. We would like to follow the line of least resistance. So you think in your mind that you would rather go out in the wilderness with these folks and deal with all these people, go back, like Sister said, he was called, he recognized the calling. But in our everyday situation that we face, which one do we choose?
Okay. If I had been in Moses' position and if I were able to see the end from the beginning, understand where God was taking me, I would have chosen that road. If I hadn't, then I would have gone back to Egypt. If you can't see the end from the beginning, then you want to go back to the known, what you know. But if you can see the end from the beginning, you can suffer those hardships because you know what's on the other side. You know what God's promised you. And if you know what he's promised you and you believe the word, then you can endure anything to get there. You know, if you really believe that. But if there's some ambivalence on your part, because they had, you know, all this, the children of Israel and all of them complained about not having the things in the wilderness that they had back in Egypt. So if you can't see that, you can't see it before you can see it, you're going to go back. I would say that.
Amen. Praise God. So if it...
Well, I would just put it to myself. Egypt being bondage, Egypt being past life, Egypt being in my life, Egypt being drugs, alcohol, etc. Then going back to that was a comfort zone. It was also a place sometimes it meant jail or something like that. It meant someone else was paying my bills. Someone else was doing for me that I didn't want to do for myself. So responsibility level was very low there. If you go this way, your responsibility level raises. You don't know how much you can handle responsibly. That's a hard question.
Yeah. I know, I agree with you sometimes. You never know when until you place them. And then sometimes when we're facing things, we don't know, there are some people do wind up actually going back into the world as we see in this day and time, make those choices. They face whether live their life before God, or sometimes it's almost seem like to some extent a sacrifice, meaning you letting go of some of the things of the world and going the right way to heal that. Making a sacrifice or making a choice. Simple sacrifice, well, you're going to come out on a Wednesday night, or you're going to do something else at home, watch your favorite TV show. So we're faced with different, you know, choices in life on different levels. And we want to be getting to the cross, but we're to make up our mind which one we're going to choose to do. On a Monday night, the prayer night, do other things. I know we have other commitments and so forth. They'll come to prayer or do other things. Monday night, they save some time football or watching Dance with the Stars. But those are choices that you can make to do the right thing or do something. And then necessarily all these things that are bad or negative, but you know, the thing that's going to enhance your life even the more, praise God, those are things that you need to be connecting to and press towards even the more. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. And even verse 26, it says, esteem the reproach of Christ greater than riches than the treasures of Egypt. For he had respect unto recompense of reward. And 27, by faith he forsook Egypt, not forbearing the wrath of the king. For he endured as seeing him who was invisible. Praise God. Hallelujah. Glory. And verse 2 says, question is, how did Moses show his faith and total dependency upon the Lord? Well, so that verse page 20, I think what I have, some of my notes, of course, to be what I'm going into all that. And then it should be what the answer what the pastor had, that by being led by the Spirit, praying to God, obedience to his voice. Praise God. And over there, like I said, down by number 5 on page 20, and you notice Moses spent a lot of time praying. Praying. And then one of the things I was talking about, it was simplified in this particular scripture here, what he had mentioned it. And it said, verse 13, 5, and right under that heading, it said, Moses prayed for God to show him his way, is a class example. And verse 13 said, I pray thee, if I have found grace in thy sight, show me now thy way, that I might know thee. That I may find grace in thy sight and consider that this nation is our people. So he sought God in all that he was doing to lead and direct him, praise God, in which way he should go. Give me confirmation, Lord. I think maybe we pray more of that, give confirmation about some of the things or the choices we make in life, especially the major decision, because you want to know that you're going in God's will. And the direction he have for you, that is set before you. And one thing that is not mentioned in here that I want to look at, one of the things that was indicating that I saw was Moses' humility. And it was the incident over in regarding Jethro, his father-in-law, I believe Exodus 18. Glory to God. Because you understand Moses, you know, man, he, at that point, God was blessing him, I mean, moving his life and doing all great miracles before him. And here come his father off and, you know, coming and giving him a visit. You know, some of you might be following off and you know, the son of law coming and giving you a visit. And just one of those, you know, they, you get to have you when you first make the initial visit with monster, and you tell them how good things going, everybody, you know, everybody well, everybody doing, how you doing, everybody doing well. Man, but when you start getting, really getting settled down into the next day, now everybody gets to see how you really live. So you get to tell them everybody doing well and doing good, and everybody, everything good. And that's most times I write, they tell them, oh, thank goodness, everybody doing good and well. And then, you know, after you get to spend a couple of days or so, then you really get to see their life, what's going on. And then you have an opportunity to give input. And this would, you know, seem like me, Moses, was they begin to exchange and tell about how well God had blessed him. And I'm getting this, a lot of scriptures in there. You can read it, whole 18. And they rejoice about how, you know, the testimony, how things were going. And I guess I'll jump over to here, 18:13. And it says, and it came to pass on the morrow that Moses sat to judge the people, and the people stood before Moses from the morning and the evening. And when Moses' father-in-law saw all that he did to the people, he said, what is this thing that thou doest unto the people? Why sit thou step along all the people and stand by thee from morning and evening? And Moses said unto the father-in-law, because the people come unto me to inquire of God. Hallelujah. Glory to God. And when they had a matter, they come unto me, and I judge between one and another. And I do make them know the statute of God and his law. And Moses' father-in-law said unto him, see, I mean, if you, like I said, if you go back and read there, you'll see how Moses and Jethro, they were sharing amongst each other, and they have built this, you know, thing, this a conversation of the theme of one perfectly well, which it still was. And Moses, apparently, he was able to do and up to the task and took upon the task and doing what he felt like, you know, he was led to do. But yet, this one I'm getting to is the submission part. How this great man of God was willing to listen, yes, to a common man, his father-in-law. Mm-hmm. In today's, I guess, natural world, we would consider, I would assume that Jethro was older than Moses was. Mm-hmm. Hallelujah. Glory to God. But in the same term, Moses had a lot more going on in his life to where he should, you know, he could have been just telling Jethro, man, this is how things ought to go for you. This is how you want things to go in your life. Hallelujah. Glory to God. And Moses' father-in-law said unto him, the thing that thou do unto the people is not good. Verse 17. He said, thou wilt surely wear away both thou and this people that is with thee. For the thing is too heavy for thee. Thou art not able to perform it in thyself alone. Listen unto me. How many times you have, you know, you talk to your fellow loved one, friend, or whatever, to give them counsel. Listen to me. And this took person might seem like they have everything going for their life, but you have good counsel to give to them. But it takes humility to be able to receive what somebody else is saying for you. They're going to help you. And he said, hearken to me, my voice. I will give thee counsel. Give me counsel? I'm over all these other people. Are you going to tell me? Did you hear me? I just told you that God is working miracles and wonders on my behalf. And then you going to come here and gonna tell me something to do.
Show me your miracles.
Hallelujah. And in fact, Moses had a submitted attitude, a submitted heart. Glory to God. And it said, I will give thee counsel, God shall be with thee. Be thou to the people, to God, that thou mayest bring the causes unto God. And let me jump over to verse 24. So Moses, the bottom line, hearkened unto the voice of his father-in-law and did all. How many of them miss a few? I'm going to pick this one here. I'm going to pick this part here. But he said he submitted all that he had said. Glory to God. Thank you, Jesus. Glory to God. Thank you, Father. So I really, that part really blessed me about Moses as well, showing his humbleness to be submitted unto someone that, you know, that can help him. Praise God. And I'm going to jump to verse number three. What can we say about Moses' faithfulness, commitment to his high call? He said, whatever God told him to do, he did. Hallelujah. Sound like you heard that in the New Testament, that Mary said the same thing. Whatever he tells you to do, oh, glory to God. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Father. And I say the same thing to you, too. Whatever he tell you to do, do it. That what he spoke to me to do, I got to do it. I ain't dead yet, but I'm going to do it. Because it has a tendency to go against, you know, my flesh. But I know that he spoke to me to do this, and I'm going to do it. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Glory to your name. Thank you, Jesus. Describe the extent, number four, is describe the extent of Moses' commitment to prayer seen in the various wilderness experiences. And the answer, Moses fell on his face before the Lord, extrudely for the people of Israel. Constant in prayer. Say it again. Constant in prayer. The Bible said we should always pray and not faint. Seeking God for direction. You know, Lord, speak to our heart. Speak to my heart today. What you want me to do? Lead me, Lord. Guide me. Direct me, Lord, in these situations. Not in our family. How to direct him, praise God, and lead him in the right way. Thank you, Lord. And number five, say, what was Moses' attitude towards suffering for the Lord and Israel's sake? And the same thing we said, he decided, I will suffer with the people of God than to live in Egypt. I mean, he knew what his calling was. And he made up his mind, I'm going to walk out what God has sent before me. No matter what the cost. Because you remember, he had this. You know, he went up and killed one of these soldiers. And also, to go back, he could have faced his own martyr for killing one of Pharaoh's guards. But he chose, it didn't matter to him. God told me, go and tell Pharaoh to let my people go. And he was with them, and we know the rest of the history. God performed miracles, signs and wonders, and got what he wanted. His people been free. Amen. Praise the Lord.
You missed the
240-day
fast.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, he submitted to fasting. No different in today's terms. He still got to fast.
Jesus
last.
Went through 40 days, too.
Yes, he did. Praise the Lord. There we go. Think we can still do it today? Amen. But, you know, thank God for this opportunity to come before you. I know it's kind of brief, but I also take it to heart of what I said earlier about getting involved and proliferating.
All right. Amen. Let's
have
praise the Lord.
All right. The man of God did a good job. When I go to North Carolina, they say, "Hello, man of God." They call every preacher man of God. I don't hear that in Oklahoma. Okay, Sister Hill has an announcement.
I want to ask Sister Yasmin or Sister Denise to give the announcement about this coming Saturday. Is that still on?
We do not know the times yet, so I think we may have to
call everybody. Okay.
All right, thank you for coming tonight. God bless you. And we're going to be calling different ones to assist us each week or occasionally in these studies. So the answer's in the back of the book, I'll tell you. So you won't have no excuse. If I call Sister Yasmin, I say, "I want you to do it next week," you're safe if you read. So stick with the answer in the back, all right? All right, let's all stand. God bless you. We'll make an announcement Sunday. We want to make a special announcement Sunday. Okay, Father, tonight we thank you as we leave this place. We leave with your blessing. The blessings of the Lord maketh us rich. Father, we are blessed with every spiritual blessing in heavenly places. We thank you, Lord, that you are for us, you are in us, and that you be for us. It doesn't matter who's against us. We are complete in you, and our sufficiency is of you. And we give you praise and the glory tonight. In Jesus' name, Lord, Father, we thank you for taking us from faith to faith, from glory to glory, and from power to power. Father, we thank you today for the spirit of holiness that's working in us. Lord, help to perfect that which concerns us. In Jesus' name. Everybody say, in Jesus' name.
In Jesus' name.
Amen. 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 Amen.